songs that we're going to be singing, we would like to offer a time of prayer for anybody who wants prayer. So this week we have Brian and Sarah Wood in back there. We wave very good hands. So if you want prayer at any time during the music, you're welcome to go back and to receive prayer. And we're going to kind of try that for the next few weeks. We're going to see how this flows and just join together in praise and worship.
So with that, let's get started. Let's come to God. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we just come before you this morning. We want to thank you. We come with attitudes of gratitude. Lord, we just ask that you send the Holy Spirit, Lord, that we might enter into your throne room this morning. Lord, we love you. We want to express our love through song. Your word says in Psalms that you inhabit or you dwell in the midst of the praises of your people. And basically all that means is that you come close as we come close to you. Lord, just give us that desire to come close to you this morning and seek your face. And we pray this in Jesus' name.
Thank you. My God.
shall be seen in all thy son of Jerusalem.
Feels and stand away. Oh,
this time, let us offer our thanks to God as we continue in worship and praise this morning. We lift up all our gifts and our praise to God. So lavish as we gather. Offerings, you have tried to give our best, but no, we can do more. In a world where forgiveness has become a rare commodity, it is often an asset we hold back to maintain power over one another. Help us to hear the teaching of Jesus in the generosity of forgiveness. May we learn to give that to others with wild extravagance. We pray in Christ's name, who gave all. For announcements this morning, we have a lot going on coming up in October, especially that first week, so draw your attention to a few of those. On October 1st, we have the Muscatine Cop Walk, which is on the riverfront at 2. We still need walkers and donors for that. If you want to know more information, you can talk to Judy Brotherton. She will connect you and help you either get signed up or learn more about that. On October 1st at 4 p.m., we are going to have a community-wide annual blessing service at Discovery Park, hosted by us and First Presbyterian Church. Bring your pet or bring yourselves and worship with animals and people together if you enjoy a time of worship and fellowship after. And there's a blood drive as well coming up, October 4th, so if you need to have questions on that or sign up, talk to Jessica and she will be connected with that information. And we also have our Jackson Concert Series that same week, a wonderful filled week of worship and celebration as we gather together. That is October 5th at 2. Announcement that is not in your bulletin, I was asked to lift up this morning, is a longtime member of Wesley, Alice Ritter, will be turning 90 on the 27th, and we would like to join in surprising her with a shower of birthday cards. So if you want to send her a birthday card this week, she would enjoy the wonderful surprise. Are there other announcements? Well, if not, then I would like to invite our children forward as we join together. Our children.
Hey, what was that?
Alice Winter.
Winter. Thank you.
Yeah. Welcome. See all of you this morning. All right, so my first question is for you. Who is a pencil person and who is a pen person? Okay, anyone? Who? Pencil? Well, raise your hand if you're pencils. Anyone pens? Then the rest of you are all pens. You prefer pens. What happens with a pen when you make a mistake? You can't erase it. So, what is your preference? Why do you prefer a pen then if you can't erase it? Any reasons? You like the permanent idea of it being on there? What do you do when you can't erase it and you haven't used a pen? Cross it out, or scribble it out, or use white out, or a different option. Now, they actually make pens that you can erase. They're really cool. They use friction to get the ink off. So even pens are not permanent, that we all make mistakes and things happen, that there is options for forgiveness and to erase them and start again. And so with that, I brought this morning, this is a cross that was made by some monks in Dubuque, Iowa. And they make actually wooden coffins which with pieces that attach to them. So this cross, for example, would be attached to the top of it, or you can pull it off and keep it. But as part of that, they have there a bed of discarded items that they thought were not good enough to go on their coffin. So they were made and they didn't fit right, or they weren't the right color or the right piece. And they opened it up. I was there for a class, and they gave us each an item we could pick from their discarded pieces. And what I was most fascinated by, if you look at this, does it look like anything is wrong with this cross? Oh, maybe not shaped a little bit, but they're all shaped that way. Because maybe it was designed that way. Maybe. Yeah, we don't know. It was in a discarded box, but I think it looks pretty good. It doesn't have any flaws on it. And yet, the symbol of the cross itself, while beautiful, is also awful. It's a horrific example of death and violence, and yet with the cross, there is forgiveness and beauty. So like this, this cross reminds us that no mistake we make cannot be rewritten or erased or made new, that through the cross of Jesus we are forgiven and given a life of hope. So anything you do, maybe that is wrong, maybe it was you didn't listen to your parents, or you were upset or angry at someone and said harsh words that you didn't maybe mean in the moment, or you did, God has forgiven you. You ask for forgiveness and wiped it clean so that you can start all over again. So our scripture passage is all about forgiveness and how hard it is to give, but that we are called to forgive one another because God forgives you and gives you unending grace, no matter what you've done. You are loved by God and worthy by God of His love. So let us pray. You'll repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for your love and forgiving me when sometimes I struggle to forgive myself. Help me to also forgive others. Amen. So our scripture passage this morning comes from Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. Hear these words. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, how many times should I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Should I forgive as many as seven times?" Jesus said, "Not just seven times, but rather as many as 77. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle accounts, they brought to him a servant loaded 10,000 bags of gold. Because the servant didn't have enough money to pay it back, the master ordered that he should be sold, along with his wife and children, and everything he had, and that the proceeds should be used as payment. But the servant fell down, kneeled before him, and said, 'Please be patient with me, and I'll pay you back.' The master had compassion on the servant, released him, and forgave the loan. When the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants, who owed him 100 coins. He grabbed him around the throat and said, 'Pay me back what you owe me.' Then his fellow servant fell down and begged him, 'Be patient with me, and I'll pay you back.' But he refused. Instead, he threw him into prison until he paid back his debt. When his fellow servants saw what had happened, they were deeply offended. They came and told their master all that had happened. His master called the first servant and said, 'You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you appealed to me. Shouldn't you also have mercy on your fellow servant, just as I had mercy on you?' His master was furious and handed him over to the guard responsible for punishing prisoners until he had paid the whole debt. My Heavenly Father will also do the same to you if you don't forgive your brother or sister from your heart." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. God, it is your word that has been heard this morning, your word that gives us life and hope, that convicts us, calling us out to follow after you, Lord, more and more. And God, I ask that this morning that you bless the words that I speak, that they be your words, even to your people. For you are holy and pleasing, God, may they be holy and pleasing to you, who are my rock and my Redeemer. Amen. When I was a senior in high school, I worked for one day at a Taco Time, a fast food restaurant there. In my first day of work, I show up, and the manager, the only other person there, was the same age as I was. She was 17, and she hands me a shirt and a name tag, and then puts me on the drive-through register. No training or anything else, and so I try to do my best. I have people that come through the drive-through, and I'm scrambling to try to figure out the screens, what I need to put in, and how to do the work, with no help at all from the other manager. And one customer comes forward in their car, and they asked for a shredded beef taco. And I could not find it. It was not where I thought it would be on the screen. And logically in my mind, I thought, well, beef taco must be the same thing. So I select beef taco. This customer, who is very impatient to begin with, is upset. She said, you gave me the wrong order. I asked for shredded beef taco, and you gave me a beef taco. And finally, I ended up calling up the manager who didn't show me, but then fixed the mistake and made the right order and gave it to the person in the window who was already upset, yelling at me because things were taking way too long. A few weeks later, after this incident, I was in one of the stores in town. And right behind me in lane, as I was checking out my items at the cash register, there was this lady who was in the drive-thru. And she saw me and she recognized me. I didn't fully know who she was, but then it did kick in. Oh, it is the lady who was really upset at the drive-thru on my first day and only day there. And she looked at me and she said, you know what, I am so sorry for my behavior. I realize now it was your first day. You were learning. And I was impatient. I had people in the car yelling at me. Things were not going well my way, and I just wanted to hurry you up. And the way that I acted was not very kind. So I'm sorry. I said, it's okay. It's all right. I was learning that. I didn't know what I'm doing. I'm sorry I messed up your order, but it's okay. And we had a little bit of a moment there of understanding, of compassion, and of forgiveness. And I think about that story when I read this passage, that how much time do we ever spend when we're focusing on forgiveness, looking underneath the surface to see the reason behind it. The lady shared with me that she had a rough day, she had people in her car who were impatient, she was getting frustrated, and that was just the last straw, and she took it out on me at the window at this restaurant. And yet, it would have been so easy for me to hold a grudge, to be like, you were treating me horribly, I had a terrible day, I quit after that, mostly because I also had another job and nobody trained me, and go on and on about it. But she said she was sorry. I saw her compassion. I saw her things underneath the surface, and I said, it's okay. Thank you. It's okay. I appreciate it. I was so glad she reached out to ask for that forgiveness. And I can't help but think of that in other examples of when I worked in retail for a while as well in college. I worked at Walmart and Target. I worked at guest services. And it is very similar in experiences. You have people that come in, and they've already had a bad day, and they take it out, it says, on you because you can't return an item that they think should be returned. And it ends up me usually crying in tears and this angry person yelling at me for something that I cannot help. In every experience, in every job you have that you work with people, there are days like that. There are just bad days where someone has had a horrible day themselves, and the only way they know how to handle it is by the smallest thing being the topic that just sets them off in a moment of anger and frustration. We begin to see differently when we look underneath the surface and ask questions, why did they respond that way? What was going on in their life? And it's so much easier then to find forgiveness. Forgiveness when you look beneath the surface, when you don't just hold on to that angry word that they said that ruined your day as well, but that you see, oh, they really had a lot going on. And it just wasn't helping them. It was just the last straw that set them off. And I can understand that, because I've had that day too. And I get that. I remember in particular one lady was coming through the register, and she was just an emotional wreck. She was trying to keep it all together. And finally, she just breaks down. She's like, look, I just found out that my brother has died. And she's like, and I thought the best option was to go to the store and go shopping to keep my mind off of it. And she's like, that's not working. I can't seem to keep my mind off of the bad news. Compassion and understanding. What is beneath the surface? What is beyond those hurtful words that you are unwilling to forgive? That's what I see in this passage a lot, because we have a scripture passage that is really blunt and hard to hear. Because Jesus, at the very end of it, says, he says, if you do not do likewise, what has happened to the servant will happen to you. That you are to forgive one another. It's not a request. It's not a calm and peaceful conversation. It is almost a demand and a commandment. Forgive one another as you have been forgiven. You have this story of the unmerciful servant who comes to the king, who has 10,000 in debt, which in this time would have been a lifetime of debt. There would have been no way that this person could have ever paid it back. He would have spent an entire life in prison. His family, his children could have been or would have been sold into slavery, and they still would not have paid back the amount of money that he would owe. And the king had compassion. When the person said, "Look, I can't pay, give me more time." He didn't just need more time. He wiped the entire debt clean and said, "You are forgiven. Go." And how does that servant respond? The servant then instead responds with what seems like anger and harshness to someone who owed way less than that amount of money. I imagine this week that anger or that responsiveness of the unmerciful servant may have been fear. Underneath the surface, wondering, could this be possible? Or tomorrow, am I going to have to be trying to figure out how to pay back this debt? Am I only forgiven for now? Is it a temporary thing? How could this king actually forgive that amount of debt and set me free? And so in response to that fear, he, out of anger, lashed out, worrying about his debt, demanding it from someone who owed him not near as much. I imagine looking at this a little differently, we can have compassion on the unmerciful servant and look at this story and wonder what was going on in his mind, because it's so hard to grasp for any of us that amount of forgiveness and grace. This unending amount, a massive amount, a life sentence forgiven because of a love of this king of his compassionate and understanding. How hard that must be to grasp. So I imagine that this servant was trying to deal with it in the only way he knew, and it was fear. What if this isn't true? How could it be true? I better start getting the money back that is owed to me. And he responds very harshly with someone with the less amount of debt. What is underneath the surface? Are we so quick to judge the anger and the frustration and the hurt that has been done to us that we don't look beyond it? That we don't look and see what caused the person to lash out? What caused the person to cause hurt? One of the things statistic-wise they look at when there's a lot of bullying going on is that they've discovered most of the time the bully is acting out because they themselves are hurt underneath. In seminary, I took a pastoral care class, and we broke up different categories of what was going on in people's lives, such as one of the categories I was assigned was, "Help, my child is a terror." And I didn't like the title of it. In fact, when I spoke to the class for my presentation, I said, "Look, that is horrible to say about your child. Instead, could you not rephrase it as, something is going on, my child is not acting normal, what is beneath the surface? Why are they acting out? Why are they doing the things that they're doing that's causing conflict and trouble? What's underneath all of that?" Because it's not just something that we do, but there's usually a reason behind every action. Maybe it's parenting, something went wrong there. Maybe it's an influence they have, a friend who's not a good influence. Whatever the case may be, to look under the surface, we find sometimes more compassion and understanding. What took place that caused this response? And we do this all the time. We walk around sometimes thinking that things are fine, but really, when you thought you were so tough, the slightest thing will remind you of something that has caused great pain or suffering. Maybe it's a loved one. You get a smell of something, a smell that reminds you of a loved one who has passed away, and it sets you off on an emotional roller coaster. Or maybe you're angry because nobody has listened to you, sat down to hear your story. You felt alone and isolated. Most of the time they found with bullying is that they wanted attention and they were acting out, harming other people because they were lacking feeling loved or welcome for themselves or not getting the attention that they thought was necessary. And so they act out in harmful and hurtful ways. How often have you done this? Somebody has said something to you that was hurtful and you stepped back and thought it over. Why did they say that? Are they angry right now? Are they just trying to get on my last nerve? Or is it really something that caused them to be upset and to take it out? In our parable this morning, forgiveness is a command, and it is so hard to do, but it's even harder if we're not willing to step back and look what's under the surface,
to see why that person has harmed us. When we begin to do that, it becomes easier to forgive. It becomes easier to see where God sees compassion and love, that we too can see compassion and love. That when a king says, you are forgiven, everything, all of your debts, wiped clean, we don't need to lash out in fear, thinking it was just a one-day activity, but an everlasting commitment of grace and mercy and love. How hard it is to grasp this parable if you yourselves feel as though you are like the serpent. Somebody has forgiven you. God has forgiven you. And yet you don't really feel that it can be true. How could God forgive me for this and this? How could God wipe it clean when I have done all of these things? And yet God does. And are you in return forgiving one another or holding that against your fellow person? Because it seems so unbelievable, or you're fearful of letting go and having mercy and compassion. Before we are quick to judge someone, before we are so quick to not forgive, dig deeper. Find out why they respond or who they are and what makes them. Because oftentimes the world around us is so full of pain and suffering that things happen to one another and we don't even know about it. And you don't even know that this person who has always said mean things from you are struggling with an emotional detachment because they were never loved or hugged as a child. So they don't know how to respond to people. They're fearful if they get close that they're going to be too close and that person is going to leave and go away. Forgiveness is possible when you have compassion and you look underneath the surface. Doesn't mean that you're going to wipe it clean from your memory, but it means that you see one another as God sees all of us, as beloved children, forgiven and holy made through the blood of Christ, that God has wiped it clean. Jesus has already died on the cross and resurrected from the grave, meaning that everything that we have ever done and committed can be forgiven and wiped clean, and we don't need to pick it back up. That we don't need to hold it back for God. That Jesus has already taking it on upon himself so that you have new life. Our punishments, our pain and our suffering have been buried in the grave with Jesus and have been resurrected to new life and new hope and joy. So don't hold up this forgiveness against someone when you may not understand the whole story. I've learned through all of the times that we tell that there's always a reason. There's always something beyond the surface. People learn their behaviors, they're struggling, they're suffering. And it is not for me to judge quickly, but instead to be full of grace, forgiveness, and compassion, and understanding. That God knows their story. I don't know the story. They might not ever share that with me. But I know that if God forgives, then I should forgive. And here, a parable this morning, that is the command. It's not a request. It's not a conversation. It is forgive as God has forgiven. Do not go and reciprocate hate or anger or your frustration or fear out on the person who has harmed you, but instead say, God forgives me, so I forgive you. The words we need to hear over and over again in this parable of forgiveness and love is that it's filled with compassion and mercy. And unending grace. Where can you find grace this week and mercy and compassion in your relationships, in your enemies, in your bullies, and those around you? And where have you not accepted God's grace for yourself? And you're holding back from God. You're holding on to a sin or a hurt or a pain because you don't feel you're ready to give it away or you don't feel it could be true. And as you pray and ask that God releases that from your heart, that you fully are forgiven, that God fully has forgiven you, that you can forgive one another. Let us pray. God, we're struggling under the weight of pain in the world. Sometimes we struggle with believing that you love us so much you would forgive anything we've ever done or ever will do. God, I pray that if any are struggling this day to be forgiven, to live into the life of grace and hope and peace beyond the suffering of sin, that you might convict their hearts, that your spirit might change and move and breathe life into the tired and exhausted lungs and hearts of your people. God, I also pray for those holding grudges against those that have hurt them, that you open their hearts to possibilities of what's underneath the surface of compassion, of love, trying to get to understanding one another more. God, help us to forgive as you forgive us. And let us lead into that life of hope and a resurrected Christ, of good news and joy, now and forever. God, as you have taught us to pray and as your Son Jesus Christ taught us, so now we also share those same words and a reminder of praying for one another as we join together in prayer. Say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We'll stand together as we join in professing a faith of a resurrected and wonderful Christ coming. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. hope, peace, joy, love, and forgiveness from Christ this week, and may you reciprocate that same forgiveness into one another as you look underneath the surface, showing compassion, mercy, and